Right, so I guess this is going to be a little bit about the earthquake, Turkey and Syria, the effect, and the 2 million homeless. It's a big number. Now, that region itself, luckily, it does have good, strong summers, and it grows apricots and dates. Actually, dates not so much. Maybe Syria more so, but yeah, the apricots, the figs. So there is quite a bit of that going on already. So there is hope for the people to become more agrarian and develop those particular old style habits, typical of the Roman times, bring in more basic wines and et cetera. And it can all be done, but we're all sitting here, well, where are they going to live? There is the branch tree construction. Because they do have so much agriculture, I suggest to the country to say, hey, we're going to buy your property. And the property of those great fruit orchards will become the new housing for these homeless people. You can say, well, go ahead and make the branch construction version where you left, but it works. It is simply a rope that you tie to a primary branch, and you bring it down from the primary down to the ground, and then you put canvas over. And it makes a little tent, and it's there, and it's available. And you and in an orchard environment, it just goes all. You can do the distance for every tree. Now, obviously, that's a beginning. Later on, that particular orchard area can become more of a village. The canyon areas surrounding can become more like a Chaco canyon, where the houses are built more into the cliffs, away from, rather than Pompeii, directly underneath the trees. But it's not something to throw away. I know it's cold right now, but the tent environment it's worked for years in Mongolia, and it's very cold there. They've lived in yurts for pretty much forever. So when you bring that simple technique, there they are, they're housed immediately. Then you only have to really start thinking about the next step, and that will be water and sanitation issues. And creating some form of latrines for everybody. And then after that, how then to make some kind of a normal existence, because those shelters can actually become quite nice, and those trees that they live directly under can become their income, can become their livelihood. And it's not something to throw away. If the country of Turkey and the country of Syria can afford to purchase those orchards, I would recommend it. It is a time step back it to go into more of a Roman era. But when you think about it, the Romans, they traveled their entire lives, and they lived outdoors much of it. They lived under trees, and they were often never housed. So it's not some. If anything, you'll be given a tent. Many of the Romans didn't even have a tent. They were simply soldiers out there in the wilds, under a tree. I imagine they used something with their horses, some kind of, they tried, to keep out of the rain. But yeah, it was a difficult situation. But now in our modern time, I'm still looking at 2 million people, and 2 million homeless people is Well, the US only has 360 million, supposedly. And for us all to say, hey, we can afford you, I don't think it's possible. I don't think it's possible for us to take. Well, we can't even afford our own homeless here. So we're dealing with a situation where we have to bring the expertise through. And yes, the expertise will be like remake a village. Well, it's not always going to be that same style of remaking a village. I believe in this environment, you have to think closer to really the agrarian lifestyle, because the ones that are going to have the worst time are the ones that are not really highly skilled. They're just going to be like, well, I don't want to move to the big city of Turkey and try it out there. I can't. I won't be able to. So they're gonna just stay close to home, but they're gonna be in very bad situation until certain things start to develop, and still their food supply develops into a real standard where they have, their winter storage. They're some kind of a root cellar, everything adopted to maintain themselves. And then the handout worry of, hey, 2 million people we have to pay for now. And for a long, long time, that won't and build a city and another city and another city. That won't have to occur. We have to at one point say, hey, we're going to free ourselves from future financial drain here, because this can happen again and again and again. And we're not thinking about the demonstrative earth that it just appeared. It'll happen again. And so we have to make some kind of contingency plan, and that contingency plan is a survival through agrarian style. When we're looking at, I know everybody wants to rebuild into modern Turkey, and so you all have a brand new yacht, but that's not going to be able to occur. That's going to be a rift. Yes, there's going to be a very large rich group and a very large poor group, and the middle class will be very much wiped out. So this is what's going to be happening in this event. Now, there's nothing wrong with having a large poor class as long as they are provided for, and if they're provided for with less taxes, provided for some kind of a cooperative for their food. So, the food growing literally above the tree that they're underneath becomes theirs, that theirs give to the cooperative, theirs to tend and theirs to care for. And that becomes the new hope, doesn't it? So as we is in America or in England buy apricots, we'll be like, well, yes, we're buying them from the homeless of Turkey, but they're not going to be homeless. They're going to start making those little shelters a little bit nicer, and they'll mud them in, and eventually it will become something that is habitable, like a real true house, a small house, yes, a peasant house, yes, but it will be something that is theirs. So in a weird odd way, it's going to be more of a rather than an urbanization of, hey, here's a big block building built, it's and go live in it, everybody. It's going to be more of a separate abode, each similar to Pompeii, but without the joining walls. Now you notice if you've ever did walk Pompeii, it's still standing. right there at the foot of Mount Vesuvius. So it put up with it, didn't it? It put up with the roar of nature. It could handle it. It could handle what it hit it, so to speak. And literally, yeah, that's a little tiny little place right there. Anyway, so this anyway, this is where I'm in. I'm in. We're fashioning it like this. And yeah, I do want to congratulate all the dogs out there. They've been doing amazing work. Some have died working. We have the one that found 40 people. Another one found over 20. So just amazing dogs out there digging until they've even had stitches put into their paws. One dog even buried his one dog buried her puppy. You know, they're aware animals, aren't they? They're aware, they're smart, they're keen. They know better. And she knew death, that little puppy dog, that she knew that she had to bury her puppy. And so these events, they're affecting everything there that's alive, you know. My suggestion for the non-semblance of a town is to actually go ahead and burn it. I know people don't want to hear that, but if it does become it's just safer regarding pestilence, and it's also in the long run, when you think of the bodies and just sitting there decaying, even after the stench, it's going to be just a terrible mausoleum of horror. And so if you could burn it down to the bones, that would be the best. Then you will have less pestilence. It's just the way it goes. Something has to be done, and those areas have to be completely obliterated. And yeah, if there's a one building standing, that's not a building to look at either. They all need to be removed. So I'm at a war event with this. I just want it all wiped out. And I want them to start fresh. Okay, and so with fresh, that brings us back to a simple life. And it will be a life more of a croft person, a life where they literally they don't own their land, but they will in be able to give, you know, what the land gives to a cooperative each year, and people will purchase that, and that will be enough to provide additional food that they would trade with, additional clothing. I and any strange things that they would need for housing. But at this point, I really think we need to start with the tree branch tent houses in the orchards. And also likewise with this, if another occurs, they're gonna be already and it's spread out more, so it's not going to be a situation of, oh my God, we lost another, 10,000 people because we put them all over there in a city. It's going to be, or, you know, a city starter. It's going to be less people would be lost in that event. So it's going to be more, I hate to say it, but it's going to be more of a, what do we call that? An urbanized, it's not urbanized, they call it suburban, more of a suburban style in the orchards. And those orchards, that would be no vehicles, of course. It's gonna be a really simple life, and water supplied at the ends of the orchard areas. If you've ever walked orchards, They're very easy to adopt as a housing facility for many people. So they actually have a good future. It's just going to be the torment right now that they're feeling of the current situation, and those that are not found, or those that have passed away, that they can't get out of the rubble. There'll be so many that they can't get out of the rubble. So probably double, I believe that's the prediction. So we just have to give them hope that the new life can even be a better life in a way, you know. Well, not a better life, but you know what I'm saying, a better life, you know, because they'll be missing loved ones and all. It'll be a better life for them. They won't be under the stress strain of the commercial situation, because I think that right now would be impossible for them for at least the next 10 years. So you really have to accommodate for their shock factor. And to accommodate for that is you have to take them out of this consumption age. And we deal with them like simple farmers that literally bring products to us, and we pay them that way. So anyway, we pay them in trade as well. And eventually, bank accounts will accumulate. And eventually somebody will have, say, we have to give them computers and be insane about that age. I just think that's the wrong move already. I just think they need to become simple, agrarian, closer to a Bedouin society, and maintain. And just maintain themselves and know that they'll be kept safe, and they won't have to be thrown off their land. That food that they can't provide will be provided, and anything that will help warm their homes more will be there eventually. Yeah, so 2 million. And okay, so I'm now going to get into the geophysical of it. I did mention that this was going to already be something to do with the magma, the geophysical change of this core of the earth, the reversal, and how the pressure, how the valleys and the mountains below our earth, our land mass and our water mass is pitted and pointed. And through that, it creates pressure. And so that pressure from that did, in my theory, cause a quake. Now, that's not saying it's not going to happen again. Anytime soon. I'm not predicting any further quakes because of it. I think that was really the gist of it right now. There were several volcanoes that happened, brand new, but I don't think it was that big of a moment more than this. I don't believe they're going to have a big quake, another one. I think it's somehow stabilized. So because many like a week has gone by now. So when we're looking next at things to ban, we need to ban any geo thermal drilling, anything that drills into the planet, into the magma area. Because of the release of extreme heat, because eventually that extreme heat release will change the core of our earth, And by changing the core of the earth, that means it will actually, after it's heated our world out, it will actually cool down. And when it cools down, our earth will die. So that's many, many hundreds of years from now. But the continuance of core drilling is really the damager, is an unstable creator that we don't need to tamper with. We don't need to kill our earth further and prove that man is a cancer to the planet. It's obvious man is a cancer to the planet, and yet we're still allowing it for some reason. Governments allow them to be a cancer. So when that stops, when they allow that, when they say, hey, banned, then we can officially be a proud people. But there is no proudness going on right now. We're not able to be proud people. We've damned our earth. Okay, that's it for today.